MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. We're going to talk about variants that have been discovered here in the United States. We're going to talk about the variant that has been discovered in New York. But first, we'll talk about the variant that's been discovered here in California.
And it's got two names. One of them is B1427, and the other is B1429. And this variant has three mutations in the spike protein. And again, the spike protein is that protein on the surface of the SARS-CoV-2 that interacts with the ACE2 receptor on human cells. The most important of those mutations is something known as the L452R mutation.
And it's this mutation that has raised concern from some researchers based on data that has not yet been published or peer-reviewed.
There's actually been a couple of teams that have looked at this at UC San Francisco, and according to their work, which has not yet been peer-reviewed or published, they found a couple of things that are interesting. Number one, they found that the virus seems to bind to the receptor more efficiently. And that, as a result, causes the virus to infect tissue about 40% more. They also found that because of this, it is about 19% to 24% more transmissible. And as a result of this, in patients who were infected with this variant of SARS-CoV-2, that there was 2 times the amount of virus in the nasopharynx. Now, in some of this research that came out of UC San Francisco, they looked at 324 patients who were hospitalized, and 69 of them had this particular variant, where 255 did not. And out of those 69 that did have the variant, 7 patients died, and out of the 255 that did not, 5 died. And you can see here that there's a higher mortality rate. But again, the numbers may not tell the whole story there because they don't know whether or not the variant was associated with a surge in cases, which could have increased the mortality rate. And so there's still work that needs to be done in terms of determining whether or not this was truly due to the type of virus or variant. The other thing that they did was they did experiments to try to determine the amount of neutralizing antibodies that were required. And so basically for this, they took an individual who had been vaccinated and they drew blood from this individual to check their antibodies. And what they wanted to do was see how much of the antibody was required to neutralize the regular virus.
And what I mean by regular virus is the original SARS-CoV-2 virus that was discovered in Wuhan at the start of this pandemic. This is also referred to as the wild-type virus.
Now, the amount of antibodies that are produced in someone who's vaccinated is several times the amount of antibodies that are necessary to neutralize the regular virus. So they diluted down the amount of antibodies until it neutralized, just neutralizing the virus. So it would not be able to infect cells. And what they did was they went ahead and designed a California variant and did the same experiment until they found that the virus was not able to infect any of these cells. So the question was, is how much were they able to dilute it before it wasn't able to neutralize the virus's ability to infect cells? Before we get to that, though, I just wanted to give you as a reference that they've done the same experiment with the South African variant. As a reference, we know how much we can dilute the antibody from a vaccinated person before we stop infection from the South African variant. And as it turns out, you need 6 times the antibodies that you would need here in the original virus to be able to neutralize the South African variant from infecting cells. What we mean to say there is that the antibodies produced by a vaccination is only 1/6 as powerful at neutralizing the South African variant. And yet, we still see pretty good efficacy of the vaccine against patients with the South African variant and its ability to prevent infections in those populations.
And I'm referring specifically to the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine, the Moderna vaccine, and the Johnson & Johnson vaccine that was just recently given emergency use authorization.
And when they did this with the California variant of SARS-CoV-2, it was only 2 times, which means that in terms of the vaccine's ability to neutralize the California variant, it seems like it's somewhere in between the regular wild-type SARS-CoV-2 virus and the South African variant. Now, remember, at one point during the winter epidemic here in California, 50% of the COVID cases were deemed to be this California variant. And as we've showed you before, look what's happened to the daily new cases in California. They've come down. Daily new deaths in California are also coming down. And remember, even the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which had a 66% efficacy overall, in the South African variant, where 15% of the study in the Johnson & Johnson phase 3 trials were done in South Africa, and 95% of those cases were of the South African variant, there were no deaths or even hospitalizations 49 days out after the vaccination. So it seems as though if we're losing efficacy in the antibodies, it's allowing more milder cases, and we're still not seeing, at least in the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, an escape causing severe disease. The other thing that's interesting to note as well is realize that we're only looking at antibody response, which is just one tool in the tool shed of the immune system. The immune system also has memory T cells, cytotoxic T cells, the innate immune system, and several other aspects of its immune system and defense system to mitigate against a SARS-CoV-2 infection. And here's the article in the San Francisco Chronicle titled, California Coronavirus Variant is Still Resistant to Antibodies, but Vaccines Should Still Work. And this article quotes Dr. Jay Levy, an infectious disease expert at UCSF, who basically found that the results released this week were reassuring. He said, the vaccines will work unless it mutates to become worse. You're still neutralizing the virus. And as the article states, there are several caveats to these early results, the most important of which is that these are laboratory experiments that analyze interactions between the virus and the antibodies in a highly controlled setting. In real life, the body mounts, as we mentioned, a complex immune response to the virus. So while some headlines state that new research is showing that the California coronavirus variant is more transmissible, it seems as though when you dig down deeper, you'll find that that increased transmissibility can be mitigated with measures that are already in place, and that the vaccine rollout, both with the Pfizer and Moderna, soon to be joined with the Johnson & Johnson, will mitigate further transmission and reduce hospitalizations and death. And along those lines, Moderna is already saying that it's ready to test its new version of the COVID-19 vaccine in humans. This new version is specifically designed to combat head-on the South African strain. And according to this article, it's not just Moderna, but other companies, including Pfizer and Johnson & Johnson, have said that they are tweaking their vaccines or working on boosters that better match the variants. And of course, one of the issues with the Pfizer vaccine has been the requirement for the ultra freezers that are required to store the Pfizer vaccine. What we're seeing here is a proposed US EUA or emergency use authorization label that would update and enable the vaccine to be stored at just negative 25 degrees Celsius to negative 15 degrees Celsius for a total of 2 weeks. And if that gets approved based on this press release from Pfizer, that would greatly simplify the ability for the Pfizer vaccine to be distributed at those more reasonable temperatures. There is currently one other variant that is quickly being discovered, and it's based on 2 papers that have not been peer-reviewed or published, but are available on Medical Archive, and that is the New York variant. So the New York variant is otherwise known as B1526, and the mutation that keeps coming up independently across the globe is also found in this variant, and that's the E484K mutation in the spike protein. In this case, there's also another mutation called the S477N mutation. As it turns out, this E484K mutation has been shown in some papers recently to indicate resistance to some of the monoclonal antibodies that have been used, for instance, by Eli Lilly. As you can see in this paper, which we will give a link to in the description below, it actually goes through and looks at a number of the different variants, specifically the B117 and also the B1351, both the UK and South African variants respectively. And as you can see, it is probably largely due to the E484K mutation that there was some challenges there in terms of monoclonal antibody therapy. And again, that's exactly the mutation that we're seeing here in the New York variant as well. Now, there are actually two teams that looked at this. One team was from Caltech, and the other one was from Columbia. And we'll give links to the papers that are available to both of those. The Caltech group basically was scanning the databases, looking at different mutations. And they noticed these mutations specifically, the E484K and the S477N. And they noticed that, at least in New York, that by mid-February, that about 27% of the isolates in New York were containing these mutations. And there's a nice article in the New York Times that summarizes a lot of what we're talking about here, titled, "A New Coronavirus Variant is Spreading in New York, Researchers Report." And here you can see the paper that was put on bioarchive.org. This is from Caltech in Pasadena, California. And they mention here the B1526 variant. They mention here in the abstract that it accounts for about 25% of coronavirus genome sequenced and deposited from New York during February of 2021. They also have renderings of the three-dimensional structure of the spike protein at the end of the article as well. Now, the other group at Columbia looked at about 1,142 patients from their medical center and found that about 12% of them had this mutation, the E484K mutation. And in looking through that article, they noticed that the patients were about 6 years older. They noticed that there was an increased risk of hospitalization with this New York variant. And as you can see in their abstract, they conclude that the phylogenetic analysis of sequences in the database further revealed that the B1526 variant is scattered throughout the northeast of the United States, and its unique set of spike mutations may also pose an antigenic challenge for current interventions, and that would include vaccines. They also have some very useful graphs here at the end of the article, which show the prevalence of the wild-type SARS-CoV-2 infection here over time, and how there has been an increase in the E484K mutation, as we've talked about. You can also see the phylogenetic tree, and you can see how these different variants have come about. So in terms of the experts, there is a little bit of a mixed opinion as to what the consequences of all this means. In the New York Times article, Dr. Nussenwig, who is an immunologist at Rockefeller University, states that people who have recovered from the coronavirus or who have been vaccinated are very likely to be able to fight this variant off. There's no doubt about that, but they may get a little bit sick from it. Whereas Dr. Reed, who is a microbiologist from Penn State, says, these things are a little bit less well controlled by vaccine, but it's not orders of magnitude down, which would terrify me. The article goes on to say, as the virus continues to evolve, the vaccines will need to be tweaked, in the words of Dr. Reed, but in the scheme of things, those aren't huge worries compared to not having a vaccine. I'd say the glass is 3/4 full compared to where we were last year. And if we look at the daily new cases in New York, we can see that they have been on the way down, but they seem to be at least leveling off here in the last week or so. And the amount of daily deaths also seems to be on the downward trend in the state of New York. And as we've said before, really what happens with these variants is a mix of how well can our immune system, either from natural immunity or from the vaccine, neutralize these variants. Ultimately, time will tell. So while the virus is fine-tuning its approach and mutating to improve its transmissibility, we on this side of the conflict are also making adjustments and changes to help meet those challenges. And from a global standpoint, looking at new cases on a daily basis around the world, that couldn't come at a better time. For more information, please visit us at medcram.com. Thanks for joining us.